why are we teaching the stuff that we are teaching in universities? Whether it is sociology, political science, anthropology, every word, every concept, every theory is imported from Europe. There's no contribution from any of us so-called intellectuals. There's no contribution, there's no link with any of our traditions, what we have learned in this society, what we, you know, get ingrained from all our, you know, conversations with our own people, with our religious people, with our intellectuals, with, you know, people on the street, with the concerns of everybody. There's no connection, there's no organic connection at all. And why do we allow the system to perpetuate, continuous perpetuation of the same system? But you can get sometimes professors teaching 40 years the same subject because they don't have to change anything. They have learnt it at one stage and now they go on teaching it. I give the example of the people keep talking about the great colleges in Delhi, like St. Stephen's and this lady, whatever,
Lady
Sri Ram and some other colleges. If you don't get into those three colleges with your 99%, then you're a failure. So 97% of the youngsters in Delhi are declared failures, you know, because they can't get into these three colleges. And the economics professor there, who used to teach from his notes, these brilliant professors teach from his notes, and every day he would end his lecture, and the bell rang exactly where he was reading from his note. So in the middle of a sentence, he would stop there. And the next day he would come and resume exactly from where he had left before. This is St. Stephen's College, Economics Department. You've got all this, you know, you have reached such an appalling state in all these institutions. Delhi University, the capital city of this country, was teaching, giving 80 marks for Western philosophy and 20 marks for Indian philosophy. Indian philosophy has changed the world. It has changed Japan. It has changed all sorts of places. To Buddhism, to Jainism, to whatever you know you call religion or spiritual tradition. But in our university, primary university, this is what they were teaching. And they said, what can we do? The students want it. As though when students come, they know what they want to study. This is the tragedy of Delhi University in just 3 or 4 years ago. I'm not talking about Puranabad. I asked them for the syllabus. They gave me a syllabus of 2002-2003, and it was cancelled. Actually, it was 2001-2002, the words was cancelled. The same book they were giving to the students. And I went inside and I found the introduction was written in 1982. The same course for 1982. So, yeah, you know, Mabdoodi, who is the founder of the Jamaati Islami, once he was giving a convocation address, and he said, you come here for your degrees, but universities have become instruments of mass slaughter of youngsters. We don't know why we call them there, what we teach them there. All we teach them is imported. Nothing is there which has come from their own minds. It doesn't relate to their societies at all. And that is why when we get this entire people, a lot of people who are coming out who are so-called educated, they are misfits. They are misfits. They are not able to really deal with innovatively with problems that their families face, their individuals, their communities, and their country faces. All the solutions also have to come from outside. The experts also have to come from outside. The scientists, everything has to come from outside. And that is the reason why we are at this particular stage. But you gave that message, and this system gives this message on a daily basis to everybody, not just only to youngsters, but to people in school. And what is the reward? I was coming here by bus from Dharamshala, Chandigarh University, the best in placements. So whole university tradition refers to the concept of placement. What is placement? You give me your life, I'll put you in some niche somewhere. You'll do some kamala, and then you can consider that after 35-40 is over, and that you can enjoy something physically, but otherwise we really don't have any. If some more creative fellow comes, what we call creative means greater energy, we will take him and we'll give him the placement and you get out. You get a displacement after the placement. If I were a young person today and I was asked to study sociology, I think that only an abnormal person would go through a course of sociology, because it's a sick science. And if I really got a zero in it, I'd be very happy, because only zero should be getting, because there's nothing that you can really learn from it. Except that it has been maintained by a tradition over the last 200, 300 years by people who studied sociology. Then they said, what do? We will teach it. They got home, they said, we'll teach it, and we'll teach it. And then the Indian sociologists want to define sociology. They pick up from what some British fellow has written on sociology. So that gets multiplied here, and it all goes wrong. It's all a bit of garbage. There's a huge quantity of garbage. I asked a professor in Bangalore, who had been teaching sociology for 30 years, I said, can you not design a sociology course keeping Indian tradition in mind? It can't be that this society, which has survived for more than 5,000 years, did not have any principles by which it organized its own society. And India is bewildering in that, because there are hundreds of different types of societies, each one organized according to different principles. No, that's all bugger all. The real society is Western society. We got to imitate that. Those are the categories which we will import, and that's how we will organize. And whatever is deviant has to be said to be deviant, and this is the normal. If you go to US, you go to Europe, if you go to Europe particularly, you look at the way young people live, how they have to get themselves literally placed into that society through some course, through some training, through this. If they are not able to fit into it, they're out. They live a miserable life for the rest of their life. Because the entire society will look at them in a different way. The people who really were failures, who really don't accept the ideals of our society, who are not willing to make the sacrifice to fit themselves into the way all youngsters have gotten to become adults and become grandfathers and so on. That's the way you have to follow. Only this system, the Indian system, is so bizarre that anybody can do whatever he wants. And still nobody doesn't, condemn you for not being educated or not being illiterate or whatever. If you're a poor man in the family, somebody will accept you and feed you, there's no problem. But there, it's very difficult. It's very difficult. When I was in Europe for 2 years, it was difficult to get, if you went to somebody's house at 1 o'clock, they were very upset. They said, how does somebody come to somebody's house at 1 o'clock for lunch without an invitation? It's so very carefully done. These are called the norms of bourgeois civil society. And insofar as we imitate them, don't pick our nose, don't eat with forks, whatever it is, we are supposed to be, in that particular creme de la creme, that type of society. But otherwise, how do you describe 1.3 billion Indians who don't follow any damn law? But we are the ones who are alive. We are the ones who are alive. The rest, most of Europe is dead. Now they are trying to listen to one 16-year-old girl trying to put some sense into their head. They create the problem. They do all this. They create the industrial society which screws up the planet. They produce the heroes afterwards who tell us what to do. They create unsustainable technologies and everything that is unsustainable, then they come and tell us you do sustainable development. But if you look at employment, if you look at psychology, all our psychological models have come from the US. The role model for standard testing in all American universities is the white American male. Have you ever found a more obnoxious standard of measurement ever? These guys are neurotic guys. Every American male is a neurotic guy. And you make him the standard for testing for normality for all males all over the world. I mean, you're insane. You're sick if you're going to do a thing like that. But this is what we're doing even now in all our universities. And we've got to stop that. At some stage, these things must stop. At some stage we should opt out, and that's why the Multiversity project was started, to say, okay, try and change this. We tried for more than 10 years. The professors refused to change. They said that we can't do anything about this. Everything is set by the university. Every coursework is set by the university. In Jawaharlal Nehru University, there's a public statement made that if you want to change one textbook in any of the courses, it takes 5 years. By the time the world has already changed and gone, 5 years, these brothers are still going on in the same thing. So why do you want to spend your life with such a dead system? And yet we will continue everywhere, all our words, every institution will continue. Look at that and say that, no, this is not for us, we will do something which is given to us by Uncle Macaulay. Because we have so much faith, we love this guy. We love everything that he wrote. About us and why we should stop Sanskrit and Persian, why we should study language, then why should we all make ourselves into babus so that we can serve either first empire, now empire is not there, we will serve corporates, we will serve these guys, we will serve those guys. But we will only continue to serve. The whole idea that we continue to serve, put our lives at the service of some guy who will give us a pittance and may allow us to survive on whatever terms he wants, is Macaulay. And he is there as a ghost in every classroom till today in Allah. You know, officially, he is banned. But in every classroom, every curriculum is still Macaulay. There is a survey of all the people employed in the United States, a very famous survey. 90% of those who are employed, 90% of those who are employed, did not like whatever they were doing. Means they were in their jobs. It was a job. Somebody has got a PhD in anthropology, he's doing something else. Like that type of thing, which is 100 times multiplied in our society here. But the more interesting part of that survey was 40% positively disliked what they were doing. Now this is the American economy. We think it's a big successful economy. 90% of them are, you know, consider that their job involvement is totally irrelevant to them. And 40% positively dislike it. This is an international survey of job satisfaction or employment.